pray for something to happen to Nick?
Something like that.
Car.
Well, you suggested it yourself once, didn't you?
I was only joking.
Were you?
Yes, I was.
Or had you started to think about it a little?
Maybe I said it, but I didn't really mean it.
Well, I say it again now, and I do mean it. Frank, listen to me. I'm not what you think I am. I've made a big mistake in my life, and I've got to be this way just once to fix it.
They hang you for a thing like that.
Oh, but not if you do it right. And you're smart, Frank. You'll think of a way. Plenty of men have.
He never did any harm to me.
But darling, can't you see how happy you and I would be together here without him?
Waiting a long time for that kiss.
When we get home, Frank, then there'll be kisses. The kisses with dreams in them. Kisses that come from life, not death.
I hope I can wait.
Hello, welcome to Movie Humpers. My name is Bob Sham.
Hi, I'm Angela.
And
we watched a movie.
The sounds you hear may be dogs. We watch a lot of them. We're squeezing in some shit because we got shit to do, but we're talking about this movie. It is Noir Month. We're calling it the Left Hand Endeavor all month long, 5 days a week, a noir movie.
Mm-hmm.
Classic noir. And we keep it rolling today with a 1946 film directed by Tay Garnett. It is The Postman Always Rings Twice, and it stars Lana Turner, John Garfield, Cecil Kellaway, and Hume Cronyn. Interesting movie, interesting flick. Before the Hays Code really went into effect, studios were gaga over this book. They wanted to make a movie. And when the Hays Code clamped on everything, it was like, we may have to change some things around.
100, because I read about what was different in the book.
Apparently, it's a lot more physical, erotic.
There's some, sadomasochistic.
I actually watched a clip of the 1981 version with Jack Nicholson and, why did I forget
Faye Dunaway?
No. I feel bad that I'm forgetting who it is, but she's pretty hot in it. But I watched, a scene, and it was kind of violent and erotic.
I want to watch it.
I'm kind of interested, too.
I really do want to watch it.
And this movie is not bad, but we go into, at one point, we get into the legal side of the movie, and shit goes kind of muddy pretty damn quick. But we get Frank Chambers is played by John Garfield. He's, a drifter who wanders upon this little diner gas station place. And the guy there, Cecil Kellaway.
Jessica Lange,
yes. The guy there, Cecil Kellaway, immediately hires him to work at the diner.
Pretty much walks outside and doesn't even ask if he's looking for a job. Just says, let's take this man wanted sign down, you're in.
They don't just take the help man wanted sign. They cut to a scene where they start burning the sign. You're never going to hire anyone. This is like that Simpsons episode where Homer goes to college. And he completed the courses. He burns his high school diploma.
I'm a college man. I won't need my high school diploma anymore.
It's so dumb, but I really think they did it just for the moment of he's burning it. And then he finds out that this knockout woman hanging around the diner is married to his new boss. Takes the job because of how hot this woman is.
Yeah,
stays because of
she
that.
Comes down. And I still don't kind of get why they explain how they kind of explain it, but I still don't get how they got together.
Basically what she said, to paraphrase.
Lana Turner, by the way, who's pretty stunning in this
absolutely.
Movie.
Absolutely. Basically what she tells him once, what's the main guy's name?
Frank.
Frank. She tells Frank that she basically had to beat every man off.
Wow. She must have been very popular.
I'm sorry. You know, like beating them off with a stick. Anyway, yeah. It doesn't get better, that phrase. So every guy she's ever met has wanted to get in her pants.
Sure.
And she was sort of just exhausted by that, to where this man comes along and he has Cecil. A business and he has money and he offers to marry her. And she told him, I do not love you.
Yeah.
And he said, well, that's okay. We can be together and you'll probably grow to love me. I'm willing to take that chance.
He also appears to be like 20 years older than she is as well.
Oh, yes.
This guy, this poor guy, this Cecil Kellaway character.
He's a sweetie.
Or Nick Smith. The actor's name is Cecil Kellaway.
Yes, Nick.
The guy is named Nick. He is a sweet guy, but he's such a fucking sap, right?
He's a drunk, too.
And a drunk. And he seems to be weirdly oblivious to this idea that, like, this guy, even though they seem to be hanging out on their own, could be running. He's got to know.
He encourages them to. Well, no, here's what I think. I think that he is not the smartest guy. And it's almost that naivete of, she's my wife.
Yeah.
So I can trust her. Even though she looks the way she looks, and this is like this strapping young man.
Have you ever actually seen anyone slip on a banana peel? Like in real life?
No.
Because I'm only in a cartoon. I feel like Nick's the guy that would slip on a banana peel.
100. Because he does run a successful business.
I mean, it's small town
He's a drunk
successful,
and he's naive.
Right? Yeah. He is quite naive.
He's a small town success. So her thing, though, is that she thinks more can be done with this place. And the interesting thing about her is she's not like, I married this man and I'm miserable and I'm waiting for my ticket out of town. She's like, I want to live here and grow this business and I love this lunch diner.
Yeah, she does genuinely love the business.
She wants to make something of herself. And her idea of how to do that is to grow this business.
And Frank, well, her and Frank kind of spark off pretty quick, right?
Yeah.
And it seems like they play pretty coy with each other, but they, like in like all these movies, they seem to kind of link in pretty fast.
There's a point at which there's almost a desperation with which she is basically begging Nick to pay attention to her and not leave them alone. There's a point where he's playing a song and he tells her, dance for us. And she's like, I'm not dancing alone, because she doesn't want to dance in front of Frank.
Yeah, yeah.
And then he says, well, I'm not going to dance. And Frank goes, well, I could dance with the Mrs. if that's okay. And he's like, yeah, dance. And they're dancing in the dark. And it's very
like
sexy.
Like the Bruce Springsteen song.
Absolutely. This comes for higher, even if we're just dancing. Because Nick just doesn't pick up on the fact that their faces, they're almost kissing. And she pushes away. And then she's like, I'm going to go swimming. And he's like, your husband said I could go swimming with you. But she truly is like, I'm going to go swimming. Nick, will you come with me? Nick, you dance with me. Like, she's begging him.
Yeah.
At first, I thought she wanted him to be jealous. But I don't think that's it. I think that she knew
guilt.
That Frank, I think there's guilt. But I think she also, yeah, she knew that Frank had the ability to blow their shit up. Because this is this attractive young man who she's obviously, I didn't get it at first. Like, why she would even give a shit about him.
With
he's
Frank.
Just the right age.
Yeah, yeah. And
he's not smooth. He's not that attractive.
He doesn't really have shit.
He's a vagabond.
At one point, they decide to run off together, and he leaves a note.
I love this part. She always wears all white.
And they're walking down the street, and she actually looks peak hot in this movie when she's like all tired and dirty, and her hair falls down.
At one point, she's got dirt on herself.
And they're walking down the street like they're gonna walk to Los Angeles. She's like, "What am I doing? Like, I have a life here. I want to expand this business. I want this business to be my future. Yeah, like, why am I doing this? We've got to go back.
I want you, but I don't want you like this. Yeah. I don't want to start with literally nothing when I have some." They get back and they're looking out the window. Nick is drunk, coming back from a trip, and he almost gets in a terrible car accident, and they watch it. And their instinct is for both of them to go, "Oh, no!" Like, she literally is like, "Oh, no!" And Frank out loud says, "Watch out!" Because they care about this man.
They do. They both care about him,
but it's like he's their father, not her husband and his boss.
Right.
And they care about him, but immediately he says, "Man, it'd be great if he had died in that car accident."
Right.
And she says, or no, maybe she says it, and he's like, "You don't mean that." And it's like this thing where it's like, that's a joke, right? That's a joke? That's got to be a joke.
Yeah.
He stays working there, and they don't basically talk to each other for a few weeks, and then they finally do, and they start hatching this plan to kill Nick. And they're talking about how no one ever gets away with murder.
Mm.
They say it multiple times. This is a pattern
we're watching all month long is this conversation.
But they even say it. It's not like we're going to do it the right way. It's no one ever gets away with it, so we have to really be careful. And this way that they try to murder him is a fucking dark comedy of errors.
Yeah.
Because it's not really funny. If I say what I'm about to say, it is not funny.
We're talking about the cat? Are we going to go talk about the cat?
So the plan is that he's going to take a bath, and she's going to go upstairs with a bag full of, like, metal balls. I don't know what the fuck those were. Bullets? I don't know. But she has a bag of metal balls, and she's supposed to go upstairs when he's in the shower, or in the bathtub, and she's supposed to go in the room, lock the door, and then hit him in the head with this thing and knock him out, and he's supposed to die in the tub. Then she's going to climb out the window, climb down a ladder, and meet Frank at the car and whatever.
It's like you got some, like, children to come up with this plan.
It truly is. And he's supposed to honk the horn if someone comes, so she calls it off. But then what happens is there's a cat. Yeah. And he tries to shoo the cat away from the ladder. And before he can get back to the car, this policeman drives up on his motorcycle and is like,
"Oh, that doggone cat climbing up that stepladder. I like cats. Always up to something."
He loves cats. And
this cop is
truly
the funniest.
I love him.
The cat gets up on the ladder.
"Look at that."
He's like, "Look at it.
Oh, that doggone cat climbing up that stepladder.
Look at it."
Which is like us every day of our lives. Look
that's
at that
like
cat.
What this is what Instagram reels are now.
"This cat climbing this ladder is sending me."
"Oh, that doggone cat climbing up that step ladder. I like cats. Always up to something." "Fashion tattoos, I don't wanna think it
through, baby. I'm so stupid in love." It's exactly. Just like you would share a, like, "Here's a cat going up a step ladder. Isn't this great?"
Yeah, and he's kind of freaking out. Like, Nick's freaking out because he hasn't been able to warn her not to do it. He knows that she's gone upstairs. He doesn't know what's happening. And he's talking to the police officer, trying to kind of get rid of him, right? And then all of a sudden, there's like a... and a scream, and the lights go out in the house.
The cat jumps onto an exposed wire.
Which was the reason why Nick could say there was a ladder there if anyone saw the ladders. He was supposed to fix that.
But he didn't want anyone to remember that there was a ladder there, and this cop comes along, and he's like,
"Oh, that doggone cat climbing up that step ladder.
Look at that cat on that ladder."
Well, but that was the excuse was, yeah, I was trying to fix this box, but the cat died on the box. That I now still haven't fixed.
It's genuinely like a very comical scene.
Well, and he runs inside and she's not locked the door, not come off the roof because duh. It went black and she screamed and she runs downstairs and he's like,
"If he dies, we're sunk. The cops saw that step ladder. If he dies, they'll know. If he dies, they'll get us. I'll get him out of there. You phone a doctor, go on."
"But suppose he saw me, what's he going to say?"
"Get on that phone and call a doctor."
Operator, this is Twin Oaks. I want a doctor. Any doctor, quick. There's been an accident. But I don't want an ambulance. I want a doctor."
So she calls the hospital, And this is when the DA has been a minor character in this story so far. The DA and this motorcycle cop show up. The DA lives down the street. So this is like the gas station. It's a lunchroom and a gas station. So he stops there a lot. So he's familiar. And he gave Frank a ride on the first day. And so he shows up at the hospital to be like, what happened? And he follows them back to the house. And that's when we get the story about, oh, yeah, I was going to fix that. But the cat died, and the little cop, he keeps saying...
He keeps going on about the cat, like, he loves
deader
cats.
Than a doornail.
I never saw a prettier cat.
Just can't stop commenting on
that
the cat.
That cat's deader than a doornail.
He loves that cat.
Oh, that poor little pussy cat.
Well, eventually, Nick does start to feel a lot better, and after comes coming home. And
before he comes home, Frank leaves.
Yeah, Frank leaves, but then he comes back, But, right?
Yeah, because Nick has hatched this crazy plan where he's going to sell the lunchroom.
So, Nick, he gets word that his sister or something is paralyzed. He uses the phrase Northern Canada. Now, is he saying, like, Northern Canada because to signify that Canada is north? Or is he saying Northern Canada like they're in the fucking Northwest Territories or some shit? Like,
he says that she's...
How Northern Canada is... This sister. But anyway.
She's in the house he was born in, apparently.
His plan is to sell the business and take Lana Turner.
To Northern Canada.
To Northern Canada. And she's going to, like, take care of her, of his sister. Right? And this is the most, like, put my foot down moment Nick has. Because you kind of feel for Cora Smith, Lana Turner's character. It's like, yeah, that sounds like a shitty way to... kind of live out your marriage.
Yeah,
like,
Cora,
suddenly you're going to go to the middle of nowhere in Northern Canada.
He doesn't give her a choice.
He literally, like, she's lamenting. She's like, I'm going to go take care of someone who's half dead. And it's a pretty harsh thing to say. But it does kind of suck. Like, because she does love the business. And now she's begging him not to. But he's like, no, we're going. And that's that.
And he went to get Nick or Frank because he is basically sold the person who's buying the business on the fact that Frank can manage it for them. So he's given Frank a job that he never actually even asks Frank if he wants.
Yeah, but yeah, he's helping Frank out, but...
It sets it up so they can all go on a trip to meet this guy the next day.
Well, Nick is fucking drunk the whole time, of course. And so then they hatch this plan.
Yeah, and I just want to point this out, she wears white the entire time.
Mm-hmm.
The first time that we see her in black... is the night before they're supposed to leave to go sell the lunchroom, and she is in the kitchen and she has a knife. And Frank comes in and he thinks that she's planning to kill her husband, and she says, no, the knife was for me.
She's kind of great in this.
She's amazing.
She's also, she really stands out. You know, you really feel for the Nick character, so he's an interesting character. Lana Turner really does kind of shine in this movie. She does kind of carry it. She's like the platinum blonde before Marilyn Monroe.
Yes.
I wonder if they hated each other.
I don't know.
But yeah, she was famous before Marilyn Monroe got famous. And yeah, you could tell her blonde ain't real blonde.
I mean, Marilyn, who knows, might have taken that from her.
Yeah. I mean, that's kind of how it always is, right?
Yeah.
You got the thing that's underappreciated. I mean, a lot of people know who Lana Turner is, who know the old movies. But there's always the thing that starts it off that is, you know, respected but underappreciated. And then something just takes that and it goes wild, right?
And there were certain boxes that female leads fit into at the time.
I call it the Sega Dreamcast effect. The Sega Dreamcast was a great little console.
I had one.
And then, like, but then PlayStation and N64 saw that shit, or GameCube, and were like, we got this. And Sega never was able to make another system after that. But yeah, so they get Nick's drunk ass in a car, and he's fucking hammered, and it's a very weird. It's very weird. The movie gets weird as fuck from this point on.
Yeah.
So there's a point where, like, he starts to get out of the car like he's going to wander this cliff, right? They're on a cliff. And instead of being like, oh, his drunk ass could just fall off this cliff, they get him to go back into the car because they just have to, like, bludgeon him with this bottle. So off camera because it's Hays Code. Though I love the dramatics of the off camera killings in these movies, where he strikes Nick, Frank does, and Nick is knocked out or dead, and then they go to roll him down the hill, but it doesn't roll far enough. The way down. So they both go down there, and they're getting into. Frank gets into the car to kind of set things up. And then the car starts to roll again while Frank's fucking around. And so then it flips and goes further down. And the way it looks, like this movie, I feel like is just, I think the cop shit is supposed to be funny. Mm-hmm. But like this felt also very funny to me, watching this car roll down that hill.
And the crazy thing.
And she's climbing up the hill and she's freaking the fuck out. And who happens to roll up? But the DA who was kind of stalking them this whole time.
He's been suspicious of them the whole time.
And so she rolls up and everyone's getting arrested and Frank's in the hospital and Nick is dead. Yeah. And so now people are going to go get charged. And that's when Hume Cronyn, who you might remember from
Cocoon.
The old
one. So
of the
many
old,
movies.
Yeah, yeah.
Cocoon was probably my first exposure to Hume Cronyn.
He plays Cora's lawyer.
But I love him in this.
The law here, quote unquote, very loose here in this world. Like we have a point where he pleads guilty for her without consulting anything that he's going to do. Like he seems like the worst lawyer ever. And then it turns out he has to retract the guilty plea. And then he convinces the DA to plead down to manslaughter and a lesser charge because, let's be honest, you don't really have a lot of evidence. And they don't because he was a drunk. And Frank was also in the car, too. So it was like, is Frank trying to kill himself, you know?
Well, what they got him on was the district attorney went to Frank in the hospital and convinced him to sign basically an affidavit saying that tried to kill him also. And so the lawyer planned the whole thing. He knew what he was doing and he kept saying, I'm handling it. I'm handling it. You have to trust me. I'm handling it. And the reason he pled guilty was to get her out of the room because that was the first time she heard that Frank was also saying that she tried to kill him. Mm-hmm. And he was afraid that she would just start spouting off and ruin everything.
Yeah.
And then she wanted to give her whole confession, and he tricked her into giving her confession to someone who worked for him instead of the DA. So there was this paper confession.
This is real
confession.
Muddy.
It's
this
so
is
muddy.
Fucking muddy as shit.
But you just have to remember that there's a confession that she signed that exists.
Yeah, she's the only one catching the charges here. But then her and Frank just get married, like in the middle
of
all this.
They get married because there's like something else going to come out about it. And you can't, I think it goes into the, she's got double indemnity because
double jeopardy.
Sorry, double jeopardy. She's got double jeopardy because she has already
pled down.
She's been charged for this. She can't be recharged.
Even though a later case against Frank, it brings up, like there are certain things, if she got charged for manslaughter, then they shouldn't be able to bring up that Frank did this, but it's not double jeopardy for Frank, but...
But that's why they get married, because you can't be forced to plead against your spouse.
Even though they love each other, they're very disgruntled at this part.
But. And the second they get married, she gets a letter that her mother has had a heart attack, and she leaves. They never even have a wedding night, right? And she goes, and the next time we see her, she's also in black because her mother has passed away. Meanwhile, Frank went and fucked off in Mexico with this woman.
Yeah.
And it's just a whole mess. She comes home and they're fighting. And then this guy shows up and is trying to blackmail them for her confession. They do one over on him and get the confession back. And then they are trying to decide whether they can forgive each other and move on or not.
Yeah. And it seems like they do. But Frank then catches charges.
She's pregnant.
She's pregnant, but Frank catches charges now, right?
Because they go to swim together. And I love this, actually. It's fucked up, but I love it. She tells him, let's go to the beach, because that's where they've had all so many happy times going swimming together. And she says, let's swim out as far as we can until we don't think we can swim anymore. And they get all the way out there, and she says,
I'm too tired. I can never make it alone. Nobody will ever know.
Cora, don't say another word, darling. Save your strength. I'll take you.
So So he saves her and the baby, and they're driving home in the car, and for the first time, it's just the two of them, and they're genuinely happy, and they're, like, lovey.
Yeah.
And I actually said out loud, look at the fucking road, Frank. Because they start kissing, and he runs off the road, and it kills her. And the fucking DA is now gets him convicted for killing her, which is the one time he didn't try to kill somebody.
Right, yeah.
So he's, you know, on death row.
But they also find a confession.
Yeah, they basically, so basically what it is he's going to get gassed and he's saying, like, I didn't do it. And the DA comes to see him and he's like, listen, even if you didn't kill her on purpose, she wrote you a note and there's enough in this note to prove that you killed Nick. So whether you die right now because of this or you get off, you're going to be right back here after another trial because you killed Nick.
But he finds some solace in the truth, I guess. Yeah. And then he has that monologue about the postman ringing twice.
I did not get that.
I maybe could have stood to watch that again. Maybe I can find the clip to play it. We'll let people, like, understand the confusion.
There's something about this that's like, well, it's like you're expecting a letter that you're just crazy to get. And you hang around the front door for fear you might not hear him ring. You never realize that he always rings twice.
What's that?
Well, he rang twice for Cora. And now he's ringing twice for me, isn't he?
That's about it.
The truth is, you always hear him ring the second time. Even if you're way out in the backyard. Father, you were right. It all works out.
I just didn't understand the whole premise, because the idea is that if you miss your chance to get the postman, he'll ring again. But what was the... I just didn't understand. Yep. It's like a second chances, but no one's having a second chance. He's about to get gassed.
Yeah, he's just happy that he's getting killed for the right reasons as opposed to the wrong ones.
But only in his mind. Only the people in that room know that.
Yeah, we got to watch that Jessica Lange, Jack Nicholson one.
Also, because after they push Nick down the mountain in that one, when they go down to, like, dirty themselves up to look like they were in the wreck, he fucking rips her shirt open and fucks her on the car. We have to watch that movie.
Yeah. Yeah. But Lana Turner is great. That's in the book.
I don't know.
I love Lana Turner in this movie, though. I thought she was really good.
She is the bright and shining star.
And Hume Cronyn is a good character actor.
Love him.
And Cecil Kellaway as Nick is a good sap.
Yeah.
But Lana does shine. She is really fun to take in this movie.
And so many levels. Like, she goes... Yeah, she plays sweet. Really good. She plays angry. She's everywhere. She's doing it all.
I assume it's the Hays codification that makes a lot of this, like, what the fuck is going on, but...
This is the one time in this Hays code era that it has been obvious that they were having sex before they were married.
Yeah.
Because they don't have a chance to have sex after. There is some infidelity here,
for sure.
She definitely had sex with him. Now, you could argue that it was after her husband was dead, but they definitely got pregnant before they got married.
And that is the 1946 film by Tay Garnett, The Postman Always Rings Twice. We're going to give this 1 through 5 each combined for best out of 10. I did this movie's confusing near the end, but I did have a lot of fun. I felt like I laughed really hard at a few points.
Yes.
And I don't know if it was intending on certain points, but there's a weird charm to this movie. And Lana Turner is great. So I'm going to give it a 3.75.
Oh, 4.
So that makes it a 7.75. It joins the rankings alongside movies like American Gangster, Nope, Past Lives, The Proud Valley, Four Lions, Inside Llewyn Davis, the 1946 film The Postman Always Rings Twice, is at least as good, if not better, than those movies. Our first full week of Noir Month in the can. Come back next Monday as we will be talking about our next Marlowe Monday feature, Murder, My Sweet, which I forget what book that's based off of. But come back here, and it is Philip Marlowe masterpiece. We'll be the judge of that. So check the show notes for links, other places to find us. Hit like, subscribe, comment, corrections, anything like that, fun facts, do so. And supposing we get out of here.
Supposing we do.
Oh, that poor little pussycat.